My name is Ming Chi, hematology oncology, and with Atlanta Cancer Care. So today, let's talk about the advances in cancer immunotherapy. I have no relevant financial relationships to disclose. So the treatment for cancer has changed dramatically over the past 10 more years, mainly in two different directions. On one side is the detection of different driver mutations that has led to the development of many targeted agents. The benefits with this type of medication is it works for majority of patients who carries the certain driver mutations. However, the efficacy, the duration of the efficacy is short-lived. The other side of directions is the evolution of molecular immunologies that has helped us design and develop different cancer immunotherapy. So for cancer immunotherapy, it only works for a fraction of patients. But for many of them, the efficacy can be long-lasting. So the concept of cancer immunotherapy is not new. It actually has been going on for decades. So we do have cancer vaccine. We used to use different cytokines for specific type of cancers. And even in the allogeneic transplant, we use the graft versus disease immune efficacy to treat disease. But over the past 5 years, this field has fast evolving. So currently, we have 8 new different medications on the market for cancer immunotherapy. And today, I'm going to focus on one type of immune checkpoint inhibitors. It's called a PD-1 or PD-L1 inhibitor. The PD stands for programmed cell death, and then the L stands for the ligand. So what is the checkpoint inhibitors? I usually tell people that it's supposed to help remove the brakes that suppress your immune system. So with this type of inhibitors, we actually help the patient's immune system to be activated, which by itself hopefully can help detect and fight against those cancer cells. So currently, there are 5 different PD-1 and PD-L1 inhibitors on the market. The first two are PD-1 inhibitors, pembrolizumab or Keytruda, and the other one is nivolumab or Opdivo. And then there are another 3 PD-L1 inhibitors, atezolizumab, avelumab, and durvalumab. Theoretically, the PD-1 and the PD-L1 inhibitors are different somehow regarding the efficacy and the side effects. However, clinically, we're still trying to identify the real difference between the two different type of inhibitors. We use them mainly by their FDA applications. So in your daily practice, you may get to know this 2 names more often than the other 3. It's because initially, when these 2 medications, when they were in a clinical trial, they look at this medication, specific medication, across all different tumor subtypes. Compared to the other 3, they try to find their special niche in different specific type of tumors. Therefore, afterwards, these 2 medications get a whole lot more FDA application or FDA approvals. All right, so according to the Cancer Research Institute, currently there are over 1,500 different clinical trials ongoing using immunotherapies, compared to 215 trials back in 2015. And they were estimating that by 2025, the market for PD-1 and PD-L1 inhibitors probably will reach close to $13 billion, which is a massive amount for such a young market. And you can see these clinical trials, they are across all different oncological and hematological disorders. So today, I'm only going to focus on 3 different applications with this type of checkpoint inhibitors. And I'm only going to talk about the New England Journal Medicine publications, try to narrow down our topic today. So the first one is melanoma. in 2013. This is an article that they used nivolumab combined with an earlier different type of checkpoint inhibitors called ipilimumab. They used this combination for first-line metastatic melanoma. And they found that at the three years mark, more than half of the people are still alive. So then they move on to look at a single agent, nivolumab and pembrolizumab. First line metastatic, and the objective response rate is about 30 to 40%. Then they move on to look at this the medication in the adjuvant setting. So in 2017 and earlier 2018, we have the final data for using the nivolumab and the pembrolizumab adjuvant setting in resected stage 3 or stage 4 melanoma. They all get approved for the similar for the same indication shortly after that by FDA. So now let's look at the lung cancer. For small cell lung cancer, we still have a long way to go. But for non-small cell lung cancer, we have made a great strides over the past few years. Only in the last month, in April this year, we have a 3 New England Journal articles published about using the immunotherapy for non-small cell lung cancer. Let's look at them. Back in 2015, nivolumab got approved, single agent, no chemotherapy part, for second-line non-small cell lung cancer. This one is in squamous cell, and the other one is in non-squamous cell. So now the nivolumab is part of the standard treatment for second-line. And the response rate is about 20% compared to only 10% for standard second-line chemotherapy in the non-small cell lung cancer. And then in 2016, pembrolizumab was approved for first-line metastatic non-small cell lung cancers, single agent, no chemotherapy, as long as the patient has the PD-L1 expression in at least 50% of the tumor cells. Response rate is about 45% compared to only 27% for otherwise previously standard chemotherapy. Then last month, the final data regarding two different types of combinations were published as well. The first one is nivolumab combined with another checkpoint inhibitor, ipilimumab, and they found a high overall response rate, about 45%, especially in tumors that has a high tumor mutation burden. And a similar response rate was seen in another type of combination as using the pembrolizumab along with the chemotherapy, first line, for non-small cell lung cancer metastatic, regardless of their PD-L1 expression. And then people start to look at in the neoadjuvant and the adjuvant setting. So nowadays, for stage 3 non-small cell lung cancer, aside from the upfront concurrent chemo radiation treatment with or without surgery, in the past, we used to just observe the patient, even though we know that the recurrence is very high. But now, after they finish the initial concurrent chemo radiation, with or without surgery, as long as the restaging scan, the tumor did not grow, then we started using the durvalumab, another type of PD-L1 inhibitors, for up to a whole year, which dramatically improved the median PFS, progression-free survival, from less than 6 months to up to 16.8 months. This is a very interesting phase 1 study just out of last month. So in this study, they used nivolumab, just 2 doses, 2 weeks apart, before the surgery, and then they take the patient to the surgery for resectable lung cancers. And when they look at the pathological sample, they found a major pathological response, 45%. The third indication is for tumors that has the high microsatellite instability, or called MSI high, or mismatch repair deficiency. So this is a feature that we routinely test for every single endometrial cancer or the colon cancer in the past. And we're still doing that. And once we see this feature, we move on to test the patient whether they have a Lynch syndrome or not. But here, for this feature is, people start to ask whether a tumor, regardless of what kind of tumor it is, if they have this MSI high or MMR mismatch repair, whether they will benefit from immunotherapy or not. And the answer is yes, based on this paper published in 2015. And 2 years later, it got FDA approved based on a pool of data from different studies. And this is the first anti-cancer medication, to my knowledge, that is approved regardless of what kind of a tumor. It really depends on their tumor feature. But if you look closely at what are the different type of cancers that based in their pool data, it's still mainly those GI tumors, like pancreatic, gastric, G junction, colon, has a lot of those cases, and endometrial. Only a few cases of breast or prostate. So by far, you heard about the PD-L1 expression. You heard about the high tumor mutation burden. Also, we just talked about this MSI high or MMR. Why there are different markers to try to look at whether tumor respond, the patient respond or not. Because as I said earlier, the cancer immunotherapy, it only works for a fraction of patients. And we try to characterize who will be those patients that will benefit from this type of cancer treatment. That's why we're still looking into different directions. So now it sounds like immunotherapy is a nice drug across all different types of tumors. Now what is the side effect? In general, it's very well tolerated medications. Especially when we compare that to the chemotherapy or compare to those targeted agents. And the grade 3 and 4 side effects usually in the single digit percent, like less than 5%. But the issue with those side effects is we really do not know, it's hard for us to predict who will have those and what time they will have those side effects and what organ will be involved. So this is an article published earlier this year by New England Journal, mainly talk about all different side effects we may encounter. So think about those autoimmune disorders like Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis, psoriasis, autoimmune hepatitis, or pneumonitis. So that's basically the type of side effects we may get into when we're giving patients the immunotherapy. And another relatively common side effect will be endocrine organ involved, like hypothyroidism, adrenal insufficiency, etc. And not to mention that there are some other relatively rare side effects like meningitis, pericarditis, hemolysis, aplastic anemia, etc. So the treatment for those side effects really depends on the degree of the side effects. It can be observation. It can have just an or need to replace the hormone like hypothyroidism or the adrenal insufficiency. But if it gets to a certain significant degree, then we use glucocorticoids. So now it comes to the end of my talk. I think the take-home message for today is cancer immunotherapy is very fascinating and fast evolving. So what I have talked about just now happens in the past 5 years. So think about what if another 5 years, another 10 years, what the treatment for, or the paradigm for the cancer treatment will be. It's probably gonna be totally different than where we are today. I'm very excited to look forward to. Thank you.